let's start with this. I know you've written about how to Democrat in the age of Trump. What would be different now if this was not Donald Trump? I mean, if we were in an age where it was, I don't know, somehow it was Marco Rubio. Let's just say, I mean, what would be the primary difference now as opposed to in that alternate universe?
Yeah. Great question, Sam. You know, I think what happened with Trump, and he is a symptom, not the disease, is that all of the sort of frustration that has built up among working and middle class folks, and not just Republicans, by the way, and not just the people who voted for him, but I think the last election was sort of the ultimate wanting an outsider to win election, and I think had more of an insider won, that frustration would have continued to fester, and it would have put Democrats in an even better position to win in 2020 and in 2018. And you know, even though Rubio's smoother, and even though he doesn't have all the controversy, or someone like him, you know, Jeb Bush, whoever, as long as an insider is in the White House, the frustration that people are feeling about being ignored, about their real problems not being addressed by politicians, is going to continue to boil. The danger of Donald Trump is that he is the ultimate outsider, and people like that. They don't like him, by the way. I mean, the polling is clear on that, obviously. I mean, with the approval ratings in the low 40s at best. And even among people who say they approve of him, a lot of those folks have mixed feelings about him. But even though they don't like him, they like that he's breaking the China. They like that he's a wild man, and that he's, you know, breaking all the rules. They even if they know that the swamp isn't being drained, they kind of like the fact that he's there changing everything. And that makes him very dangerous, I think, as we go forward. And I think it heightens the need for Democrats to be more aggressive and be more of the outsider grassroots party.
All right. So, okay. And then that leads us in there. But it, I mean, it's interesting. It's an interesting take that would grow. And I guess theoretically, right, it would come easier to Democrats to be seen as outsiders just simply because they were, as opposed, you know, because there was someone on the, there was an insider sitting there. Now, of course, I frankly don't know that Marco Rubio would have been able to win, but it is interesting to contemplate that alternate reality. And we should say, and maybe we should also start with the notion of, like, you know, what does the loss tell us anything different than, I guess, maybe you've already articulated it, that this was a moment for outsiders. And when we say this, we should also, you know, acknowledge that 95%, I don't know, maybe it's higher, of the people who voted for Donald Trump, you know, voted for Mitt Romney and John McCain, or yep, would have, yep, were they of voting age. So that we're really talking about a rather small swing of the electorate, to the extent that we're talking about that. So let me ask you this. When we look at 2018, when we look at 2020, is the idea to work on that small group of people who swang from Obama to Trump? Is it to look at those people who normally voted Democratic but just stayed home in 2016? Or is it also, and maybe it's a combination of all three, to look at those people who maybe never have voted or, you know, rarely vote, and motivate them to come out? What is the focus that Democrats should have, and are they mutually exclusive?
Well, I argue in the book very strongly that they are not mutually exclusive, that it's all of the above. And it's one more segment as well that you didn't mention, which is the people who voted as a protest for third party candidates. The 2016 election was the highest third party vote since the days of Ross Perot in the early and mid 90s. And that was a huge factor. I mean, it absolutely lost us Michigan and Wisconsin. It probably lost us Pennsylvania and New Hampshire and a number of other states as well. I mean, I'm sorry, not New Hampshire, but potentially a number of other states. So there are four segments of the electorate: the three you mentioned, and then the protest voters. And what I argue in the book is that rather than saying either or, rather than like having the choice, well, we have to do swing voters. No, let's do base voters, which has been this argument that I feel like is a never ending argument in the Democratic Party. I argue that there is absolutely a path and a message where we can appeal to all of those segments at the same time. And it's by focusing on what unites people, which are economic issues, but with a frame around race and class. I don't believe you're going to do it just with a Bernie economic message. I think Bernie's economic message was very powerful and very important, but I don't think you're going to do it with that alone. I think one of the ways Democrats screw up is that they try to avoid tough issues. Toughest issue in front of them is this whole race class kind of thing that's going on. But I believe that if you lead with that, if you open with that, and talk about race and class together, and say, look, Trump and the Republicans are trying to divide people on the basis of race. They're trying to get people to hate each other on the basis of race because they want to pick your pocket. I think if you make that argument, it actually works. And there's research that I cite in my book, very powerful research that shows that kind of argument where you deal with it up front does work, and it works for all those segments of the electorate that you were talking about.
In terms of math, is it necessary to go to all those segments of the electorate, or is it just we shouldn't even focus on it? In other words, are we reverse engineering something that doesn't necessarily need to be reverse engineered, or should we just go with the strongest message? And you know what I'm saying?
Well, yeah, and I totally hear what you're saying, and not the answer is not necessarily, but what I argue in the book is that because of the ingrown electoral advantages that Republicans have, the bias in the Constitution toward rural states, for example, the voter suppression that the Republicans have succeeded in passing in a whole lot of states. The other chicanery that goes on in different places. What I argue in the book is that Democrats, in order to have a sustainable majority, not just win a particular election on a particular day, but a sustainable majority over time, that what we need to do is we need to start winning 55-45. And I do believe there's a path to doing that. I think the strongest kind of message is an economic-based message that acknowledges that we're all in this together, that fights back against Republican race baiting, but goes from that, pivots directly from the argument about race baiting to the economy, and lays out a strong populist, if you will, economic agenda.
All right, we got to take a quick break. I'm talking to Mike Lux. He has written How to Democrat in the Age of Trump. We're going to take a quick break. I'm Sam Cedar. This is Ring of Fire Radio. When we come back, we'll talk about those obstacles to democrating in this age of Trump. Right back.